just got a letter. We just got a letter. We just got a letter. Wonder who it's...
I wonder what we're going to be learning in this lesson today. Very interesting. We're going to be learning about covalent and ionic bonds. What do you guys think?
Hey, Andrew, how do you feel about today's lesson?
Great.
So in this section, we're going to focus on the covalent bond first, and then later on we'll be focusing on ionic bonds. What are covalent bonds? Covalent bonds are basically when two elements share one or more electrons, and within those covalent bonds, they're going to be sharing electronegativity. In which, what is electronegativity? Electronegativity is the ability to attract electrons within the elements. So within a covalent bond, there's going to be two different types of covalent bonds. They're going to be nonpolar and polar. In most situations, when it comes to nonpolar electron or nonpolar,
discard this, blah blah blah, edit it out.
Okay. So within a covalent bond, there's going to be two different types of covalent bonds. They're going to be nonpolar and it's going to be polar. So nonpolar covalent bonds are going to most likely be non-metal. And the reason why is because non-metals, by sharing their electrons in the outermost shell, electrons are going to fill up that shell, in which non-metals focus on gaining those electrons and not losing them. And that's what covalent bonds are. Covalent bonds are about sharing and basically being stable within each other and enjoy each other's company within these elements and within these atoms. So that's why in a nonpolar situation, it would be considered a non-metal. Compared to ionic bonds, they're both positive and negative. So it's going to be non-metal and it's going to be metal, which we're going to focus more in depth when we go into ionic bonds. So the first type of covalent bond we're going to be discussing is nonpolar. Within a nonpolar covalent bond, what's going to happen is the shared electrons in the middle of the two elements, which are sharing the electrons, will be shared equally by the bonded atoms, which resulted in a balanced distribution of electrical charges. Which means that the diatomic basically means two molecules or two elements combined together, both have the same charge and electronegativity and isn't used because they're overpowering each other. So basically what it's just saying is that since they both have the same charges and they're not gonna overpower each other because they are stable within themselves and they're not gonna wanna overpower because it's gonna cause chaos, which we're gonna discuss within the polar covalent bond. But overall, it's just gonna be focusing on sharing those electrons and having equal distribution within the nonpolar covalent bond. That results in receiving the balanced distribution of the electrical charge. So additional information that we could add in the nonpolar covalent bond is that two non-metal atoms that have the same electronegativity and therefore will be equal sharing of bonds of electrical pairs. I have an example that I could just say out loud, but we'll discuss and get into depth more. So for example, hydrogens and hydrogens, when they're both connected together. So hydrogen is a 2.1, and hydrogen, which we're going to subtract it to find their atomic difference, or their covalent, or their polar, their atomic, or nonpolar. So they're both going to be 2.1, right? So because they're together, it's going to be a hydroxide, or just going to be hydrogen. So it's going to end up being zero because they are not overpowering each other and they're going to just share and be distributed equally.
It's a covalent bond in which the bond and atoms have an equal attraction for the shared electrons. So basically what this is saying is that since the two elements are bonded together to form a covalent bond, one of them has to have a greater electronegativity that the element next to it has. So with electronegativity, it's going to hog those valence electrons to take for itself in order for it to be stable. So they have to start the process of a tug of war.
So sorry that my fellow partner's not here today to explain the tug of war process within a polar covalent bond, but I will be here to explain it myself. So as you guys heard, though, that within a polar covalent bond, one element is going to have a higher electronegativity than one other element. And the reason for this is because, as you saw in the nonpolar, basically that meant that they both have the same element, hydrogen 2.1, hydrogen 2.1. Remember as I said? Well, in the polar, they're both going to have two different elements. So within these two different elements, what's going to happen is one element, for example, let's use fluorine, for example. Chlorine. So for example, chlorine would have actually a higher electronegativity than a hydrogen, which is a hydrogen is a 2.1. So as she said before, that within this process of the covalent bond or the polar covalent bond, one is going to have a higher electronegativity. Well, that is true. But although it wants that valence electron, because again, it's a non-metal. Although they're both non-metals, an example of a higher electronegativity element would be chlorine. Chlorine would have a 3.0, while hydrogen would have a 2.1. So within these bonds, non-metals want to gain electrons and they don't want to lose electrons, which is going to result in that tug of war process, because although the other element doesn't have a high electronegativity as chlorine or as any other element, it still wants that electron. So they're both going to be fighting for these electrons because they want to gain electrons and not lose electrons, which is going to result in the tug of war, or it's going to result in that conflict, in that pooling conflict, which is considered to be a polar covalent. So to identify this, we can subtract the 3.0 and 2.1. So when you subtract those two values, so for example, to find the electronegativity between these two elements, such as chlorine and hydrogen, you're going to subtract the 3.0 and the hydrogen 2.1, which is considered to be 0.9, and which is going to fall in that category in the ionic scale, or the scale of polar, nonpolar, and ionic, and it's going to fall into that polar category, which makes it a polar bond. Additional information is that these type of bonds basically create hydrogen bonds. So now that we have discussed about the electronegativity within a polar bond, you must be wondering, which one is going to have a higher electronegativity? Which one's not going to have a higher electronegativity? Well, we're going to use this one good method called Diplo. Diplo is basically the separation of the charges. So with Diplo, an illustration to demonstrate which one has a higher electronegativity and which one has a lower electronegativity is going to be through these arrows. So with Diplo, it's going to demonstrate which element has a higher one and which element has a lower one. So basically, since they don't focus on gaining or losing electrons. So an example of Diplo, or just the polar electronegativity, polar electronegativity, oxygen, for example, is going to have a higher electronegativity due to having a higher percentage of electrons, which is 3.5. So it's going to be partially negative because it's gaining that power and electronegativity or electrons. Compared to hydrogen is going to have a lower electronegativity, which is going to result in having a partially positive sign due to the lack of electrons it does not have, because remember, oxygen has a higher electronegativity than a hydrogen. It's supposed to have a higher electron count in order to beat the oxygen in electrons. Since positive, in which means it's going to be losing its power and receiving those electrons.
So how do you feel about this new lesson?
Great.
So what have you learned so far?
Covalent bonds.
So now we're going to continue the lesson with talking about ionic bonds.
Ionic bonds is the attraction between a positive or a negative ion. Ion is the loss or gain in electrons. So if the ions have less than 4 valence electrons, that means it is going to lose their certain amount of electrons to form an octet to be stable. With the amount that they lose, it is going to transfer those electrons to the element that they bond with. which needs those electrons in order to complete the octet. Those atoms are called ions, in which they want to gain electrons because they have more than four valence electrons on the outer shell. Also, in order to form an octet, it has to lose its outer shell because they lose electrons due to nothing more than four valence electrons.
Hello guys, so we're back to ionic bonds, and my fellow colleague is not here today, unfortunately, but she was talking about how basically when an ionic compound, basically it's going to lose or gain these electrons. And the reason why is because within these shells, within these orbitals, they have to have a full octet. An octet is basically just saying that there has to be eight valence electrons in general. So, for example, if an orbital or if the last outer shell doesn't have eight valence electrons, that means it's going to have to lose that shell because it is considered unstable, and which is going to lead to it giving it to another element that it's bonded with, which does have almost a full set in its outer shell of eight valence electrons. So what's going to happen is it's going to have that process of basically exchanging these valence electrons. So, for example, the first orbital or the first the atom that I was talking about, basically it's going to lose that electron because it only has, for example, if it only had one valence electron, it's going to have to lose it so that it could be stable itself, and that valence electron would have to go to another element that is onto its full set and its outer shell of an octet rule. So what about the element that does not have a full set of eight valence electrons? Well, what's going to happen to that is it's going to lose its outer shell so that it can form a stable bond, and both of them will be stable together. So for example of an ionic bond, so you know what gives the name sodium chloride? Well, they're together in a bond, but in order for them to actually combine together, sodium needs to lose an electron to become stable itself because it doesn't have enough electrons. It doesn't have enough electrons in its outer shell to be stable. And chlorine needs to gain electrons to become stable. So with both needing each other to benefit each other, they're going to come together and they're going to form an ionic bond, in which it's going to have that process as I explained earlier. Ionic bonds of sodium chloride, this will only happen when they bond together and both have opposite charges. So for example, a sodium would be considered metal, while a chlorine would be considered non-metal. So they would both be together because they're both positive and negative charge. Remember, non-metals are not really, they want electrons. And yeah, so for example, non-metals want electrons. They want electrons, so they're gonna be considered the negative charge in this point. And sodium, they are considered metals where they lose electrons. So that's why it's gonna have that process of losing and gaining those electrons because of the non-metal and the metal that involves around this bond. In which sodium loses an electron to become stable, and it transfers it to chlorine, and they only need one electron to complete its octet rule to become stable in general. To determine if it's actually proved these bonds are ionic, it's through its electronegativity. Think of it like this. Because ionic bonds have the ability to give up an electron and give it to another element, it could be so that it could be stable. Well, in the process of actually giving up an electron, it would be like electronegativity, because electrons are attracted to the element and it takes it to the complete octet. Additional information of ionic compounds would basically, ionics are formed in what's considered to be an ionic crystal, which I will insert right now. Which is the arrangement of the opposite charges in which between the nuclei and electrons are adjacent ions. But what actually gives it its crystal structure would be considered crystal lattice, which I will also insert in the video. Which is orderly arrangement of electrons and protons. So that is basically it within these two lessons, and I hope that you enjoy watching this video. And we're going to move on to the student actually teaching the lesson.
So now that you have learned the lessons throughout the lecture, do you feel ready to do it yourself?
Yeah.
So are you ready to start your covalent bond lesson?
Yeah. Covalent bonds are formed when elements share one or more pairs of electrons. These two elements are gonna combine together and make a covalent bond by sharing their electrons.
I'm sorry for interrupting your lesson, but I have a question.
What is it?
What does that represent?
So there are two hydrogens combining with the oxygen, which is H2O.
I have another question, if I should ask. What kind of bond are they?
A covalent bond.
Since you answered your question correctly, you'll be given a candy!
Yay!
And every time you do answer a question correctly, you'll be given more candy!
So now you can continue your covalent bond lesson.
Covalent bonds is to be nonpolar because they share electrons in between the elements. In the bond, they are going to share electrons equally. Ionic bonds want non-metal because it's positive charge in which combine negative and positive.
Sorry to keep interrupting your lesson, but I have another question.
What is it?
How many valence electrons does an element have?
That's easy. It's 8 because from the Artec rule. Ionic bonds is the attraction of positive or negative ion.
Good job, Andrew. You got 100%. Do you want some candy?
Covalent and ionic bonds with such amazing teachers like Marina and Vivian. Thank you very much for helping me learn something new today.
I hope you enjoyed the video we've created about ionic and covalent bonds. The end.